Welcome back to Tuesday with Truth Attack Hour with Tyra Antolik, where religion, politics, and the law are mentioned all in one breath. If you want to call a show, the number is 410-848-9191. I have really exciting news for Liberty Works Radio Network. We have a channel on YouTube now, and we're archiving the shows, and that is really, really great because somebody got the great idea, somebody put their fingers to work, and I appreciate Dick and everybody else that's involved in getting all this up and running, and it's great. So when you go to, you know, do a search, Liberty Works Radio Network, go to the channel, go to the playlist, and you'll see everybody that's on there. All the shows are not up, but hopefully and eventually they will be, and it's, I don't know, it's my dream come true. I am really, really so excited about all that happening. And, you know, if you want to visit our website, lwrn.net, by all means, there's a lot of information there. There's a link to the playlist so that you can go there directly from our website, and you can also visit truth-attack.com. Okay, have you ever had a day where you woke up in a total fog and you're trying to get your brain in gear and your mouth in gear and it's just not connecting? Well, I woke up like that today, and you know, those are times that you have to plow through, but hey, I'm gonna do it. I have information here about the Islamization of our educational system. A lieutenant commander in the Navy got exonerated for his being a chaplain and the things that have to do with being a chaplain. Bernie Sanders and going to Liberty University, that was kind of interesting. And then Congress being involved in having the moral issue of standing with the poor. And finally, what does the situation with Kim Davis have to do with the Feast of Trumpets that we just celebrated yesterday? Very interesting stuff, because as if you're a Christian and you know this, the feasts were concerning things to come, and if you follow the feasts and you know what's going on with them, you know that the last three have not been fulfilled as the first four. So I'm going to connect that with Kim Davis. I put on my e-blast Kim David, and I'm going, and I sent out half of them, and I'm going, oh my gosh, I put David instead of Davis, and that's the fog that I've been all day, you know, and I try to fix it before anybody got totally discombobulated. My niece used to call this condition, when she was 3 years old, she would call my condition being fweaky fwacky, and that's exactly what I feel like today, fweaky fwacky. But anyway, nonetheless, I will prevail, and I will go through all this stuff and make sense of it, hopefully entertain you, hopefully inform you, hopefully challenge you to do something with your life other than listen to me. Do something, and that's my whole purpose of being here. Give you the information so you could take it and do something with it. Okie dokie. Well, just some information right now, because this has to do with a lot of states, and you understand that, I'm just going to assume that you understand that the educational system is just going, like my niece would say, fweaky fwacky. And with Florida, Tennessee, Oregon, Pennsylvania, all of these places that are having the state standards, the Common Core deal, and all that kind of stuff, well, what does that have to do with the Muslimization of the educational system? Well, there are a lot of schools that are quite all right to have their students, eighth grade students or younger or older, maybe the entire 12 grades, to pretend that they are Muslim, to recite the five pillars of Islam as a prayer, to make Islamic prayer rugs, and to perform other Muslim rituals That's what's happening in Florida. In Tennessee, there was an assignment that including writing a declaration that Allah is supreme and textbooks that recount Islamic doctrines as fact instead of beliefs. Well, the ACLU and Jay Sekulow are putting out a petition, and if you agree with him, by all means, go to his website and sign the petition. There's something that you can do. Because when Christianity is brought up in the same, I've never in the entire time that I was in American, you know, school system, 60s and 70s, well, it's a different time, but nevertheless, I never experienced the obligation to perform any religious act within the context of knowing that religion. Never. Now, if you go to comparative religions in college, you might have to do that, but not in, you know, your formative years up to 12th grade. Well, now they're doing this in 8th grade. And had that assignment been about Christianity, about Jesus Christ, about saying that Yahweh is the supreme God, oh, the ACLU would have just, you know, rush right in and said, oh, it's unconstitutional, you can't do that, like they always do. How about a statement like this? Origins of Islam includes a statement such as, around the age of 40, the angel Gabriel told Muhammad that he was to be a prophet of Allah. Okay, well, that's a statement of fact, but that fact is within the confines of a belief. You know, it could be a fact within the belief, but did it really happen, or what happened there? You know, why is it that they don't, you know, they say, well, it's a belief that Jesus was born in a manger, and the Magi came over and gave him gifts because they saw the star from the east and all that. Oh, no, can't do that in the public school, but you can do this now. And Tennessee says it gives the state standards as to why Christianity was not included, or they're saying it was postponed to a later grade. But if you're including or doing comparative religion in a certain grade, in a, you know, you got entire semester to do the entire year, let's say, to cover this, it shouldn't have taken much longer to include this. But the state standards did not cover it. And I, if I were a betting woman, I would say that that was the common core standards of that state for that grade. You know? The state standards, that's why they didn't include Christianity. Are they going to include it in another, you know, session? Well, maybe, and I hope they do. But I hope they go in depth, too, as much as they are with this, because now they're saying they're also teaching the Shahada, the profession of Islamic faith. And yet so many schools, I've heard, read and heard about so many students that when they're given the free choice of writing an essay of whatever is important in their lives and they mention Jesus Christ, all that essay is going to get an F. Oh, because we're not allowed to include religion and blah, 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 blah. And yet with Islam, it's quite all right because we have to be expanding our minds to include all these other diverse religions and Islam. Well, how many are coming in? 125,000 a year or something, you know? And now with the Syrian problem, they want, I don't know, well, the Syrian problem, that's a whole other issue. There are a lot of Christians that are fleeing, but if I were a betting woman again, I bet you there will be a lot of Muslims coming in with that too. So, Jay Sekulow and his ACLJ organization are looking for petition. But I got to tell you, I don't know that they're going to get too far because already the Ninth U.S. Circuit Court of Appeals has ruled that such, quote, indoctrination about Islam was permissible as cultural education. Permissible as cultural education, and yet they're removing the Ten Commandments from all over the place. And that doesn't, you know, fit my brain, because the Supreme Court has already stated that the Ten Commandments are part of our cultural education. It's part, you know, of our history. And yet there are cases won back and forth that are taking the Ten Commandments out. So I just want to let you know, for those of you that have kids in school, to keep an eye out on this stuff, because that's what's going to be coming on. You know, and by the way, in Florida, if you don't already know this, Jeb Bush is for Common Core like no tomorrow. He really likes it. And I don't know about this guy. I mean, anyway, what can I say? All right, onward. Concerning this lieutenant commander, chaplain Wesley Motter, I covered his story back in March of this year. And basically what happened with this man, just to give you a little rundown of what occurred. As a chaplain, he was counseling people, obviously, and he was saying things that his commander did not like. At least that's what the counselees were telling to the commander. And these are some of the things that they were telling him about this chaplain. And I want to read some of these to you. That the, and his name is Motter, Lieutenant Commander Motter, told a student that she was shaming herself in the eyes of God for having premarital sex. Told another one that homosexuality was wrong. He told a third that the penis was meant for the vagina and not for the anus. he insinuated that he had the ability to, quote, save gay people. He asked a staff member about her sexual conduct and then told her that she should be in love with God and not her partner. He berated a pregnant student for becoming pregnant while not married. And so for these things that these students told this commander, because they are trainees at the Naval Nuclear Power Training Command. That's what I'm saying, students. He was, you know, counseling with these students. But this man is a Christian. And so what happened, he was just pretty much released from duty. The commander, his name is, where is his wonderful name? I'll find it in a minute. Anyway, the commander said, you're not going to be here anymore. We're not going to have you. Commander J.R. Fahs. F-A-H-S. According to our support, he said, I will support your religious freedoms and sincerely held beliefs. My decision to relieve you are based on your failure to comply with references, blah, 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 not the exercise of your religion. That's what the total ignorance is. Because part of the three exercises of religion is, what is it? Teach all nations what I have told you. That is Jesus saying the Great Commission. Teach all nations what I have taught you. And part of that teaching is how you behave. Anyway, I'll continue on the other side of the break. What the Navy finally decided about Lieutenant Commander Motter. And we'll continue on other things. So don't touch that webpage, don't touch that dial. I shall return. Okay, thanks for staying on. The number here, 410-848-9191. I was talking about Lieutenant Commander Motter, who in March of this year was discharged from duty as the chaplain of the Naval Nuclear Training because of his counseling advice to several of the students there. And yet, in the Navy commander over him, he says, I'm relieving you because you have gone against the standards, the policy of the Navy in inclusion, in sensitivity. But see, when you go to a Christian chaplain counselor, if he has any worth, he's going to tell you what the scriptures say, and that's what this guy said. Well, the Navy exonerated him and reversed Captain Foss's relief of him. And they also overruled Foss's March 16 letter, in which he denied Motter's formal request for religious accommodation under Navy regulations. So there is a provision in Navy regulations for religious accommodation, but that word accommodation is thrown to everybody but the Christians here in this country. We have to be accommodated too. There are provisions to be accommodated. So why aren't they doing it? What is behind all this stuff? Because it's just, maybe I'm just looking at a lot of things that just accumulate in my brain about all this, and I see it everywhere. You know, like when you have a red car and you're driving down the road, all of a sudden you see a lot more red cars on the road because you have a red car. Well, that's the way I'm looking at this, is that every other article bleeps on my radar where religious accommodation is being denied Christians here. And so what can I say about this? I'm glad that for at least somebody in the Navy, they recognized that Christians, even if they are, you know, in a high-ranking position, still have their religious rights and still can exercise the very job that we hired, i.e. a chaplain. Hello, Captain Foss, you know. How ignorant could they be? But this ignorance, this misinformation, this total squeaky-flocky thinking is rampant in this country. I just cannot believe it. I every day I can't seem to wrap my brain around this stuff. How ignorant people are. Is it really happening this way, man, that people are that stupid? It's beyond belief, man, beyond belief. Okay, now here's another one. You know this wonderful old senator by the name of Bernie Sanders, don't you? Well, he was invited and accepted an invitation to speak at none other than Liberty University. And Liberty University was founded by the late Jerry Falwell. And we all that have a little bit of, you know, years under our belt know who he was, what he stood for, and all those types of things. Okay, well, I really like Liberty University, and I like Liberty Counsel. One of its attorneys, who was my nephew's attorney, when this homosexual stuff, I should say stuff, hit the fan with him in Pennsylvania. And they were, you know, his attorney there. But here's the thing, and I would love for you guys to call and say, you know, hey, well, I agree with Sanders here. If you're Christians, tell me I agree with Sanders here, or tell me that you don't. 410-848-9191. And here's what he says. Here's what he says. He suggested that a handful of people have wealth beyond comprehension, while other people shouldn't have to struggle to feed their families, votive over their heads or visit a doctor. Quote, when we talk about morality and when we talk about justice, we have to, in my view, understand that there is no justice when so few have so much and so many have so little. And he got applause. And all the undergraduate students had to be at this speech. About 12,000 students, they had to be there. Okay. The school's senior vice president, David Nasser, and he's senior vice president for spiritual development, drew loud applause after the speech when he told Sanders on stage that while most Christians agree it's immoral to protect billionaires at the expense of society's most vulnerable citizens, they would say unborn children need protection too, because as you well know, Sanders is, you know, pro-choice. He is not against abortion. So I would think that that is a contradiction right off the bat, because a lot of women, you know, have abortion performed on them because they can't afford having a baby. Well, you know, if I would think that if I know I can't afford having a baby, don't you think I would do something not to have or engage in the activity that would produce a baby, so that then I won't have to abort it? So that then I would even be more impoverished because I would have to pay for that baby? Why is it that that rationale doesn't, you know, measure in? It's not calculated in. Oh, we're just going to have sex with, I love you so much. Oh, I love the way you kiss me. And then it's, oh, but I'm so poor. We got to get the rich people to pay for this. See, being poor, there's a whole lot of variables involved with this. It's not just that you are born poor. It's not just that. There are a lot of other things that may lead you to being poor. And a lot of it has to do with really poor decisions in your life. So, you know, should I protect a billionaire? No, I don't want to protect a billionaire. I don't even know what he's talking about when he says about protecting a billionaire, other than maybe tax stuff. You know, but you're not protecting a billionaire at the expense of the poor. I think what makes a billionaire, what makes a poor person, doesn't necessarily come with the same parameters. The Student Government Association president, Quincy Thomas of Dallas, said Sanders connected with students who were excited to hear a different perspective, and that's fine. That's what college is for, right? The marketplace of ideas. I heard that all the time. Thompson, a pastoral leadership major, said Sanders' statistics on poverty struck a chord with him personally, but he said churches, not the government, should address those issues. Well, I agree with the guy. How about just communities, neighbors as a whole? And see, I'm glad in a way that Sanders went over there, because at first when I saw this, and oh, you got to be kidding, he's going to go to Liberty University, but I'm glad he did. But then he says this, Sanders, I believe Christ tells us to help the poor, feed the needy, and shelter the homeless. Yeah, he tells it to who? To government? No, he doesn't say it to government. Sanders, if you want to do that, you do it yourself. Don't put government in there. You do it. Another student, 19, says, Derek Atlas says, I like how Sanders wages war on poverty, not poor people. Well, you know, when you go to a university that has a lot of Christians and you say a lot of, quote, Christian stuff, you're going to strike a chord with young Christians. You will. But the fallacy of this is that the moral issue, doesn't fall upon government. The moral issue falls on each individual, unique, separate person, man or woman. That's what Christ was telling each of us. He never told Caesar and the Roman Empire to do it. Never did. So, anywho, that's my two cents on that. Whew, I want to roll here. Okay, now, here comes Congress. And doing something similar, okay, and I'm not totally, I don't know, maybe you guys can call in and tell me how off I am. I would love to hear people how off I am, and then I'll tell my producer to say, thank you very much, see you later. No, I'm just kidding. Okay, Congress members urge U.S. to help Syrian refugees. We have good hearts and scriptural obligation. Okay, so here's another scriptural obligation that a lot of people are saying we have a mandate to keep. And this is a little bit different because I myself was a refugee at one time, a refugee from Cuba. And I remember when part of my family came from Cuba through the Mariel lift. And Mariel was a little bit different than the way I came. I came, you know, by air. I already had my grandmother sponsoring my dad and our family and her other 9 kids, okay, to come over. But this is a little bit different. So members of House of Representatives, both parties, are being moved by activists to that they have a moral obligation to help Christians and other religious minorities that are affected by the refugee crisis in Syria. So now they want to do legislation. They want to say, okay, well, let's see what some of these people, and this was just a conference, you know, that only 17 of, you know, how many people in the House, you know? What is it, 400-something? 17 members, or at least 17 did something, okay? They talked about something. Representative Peter Roskam, Republican of Illinois, asserted that American Christians have a scriptural obligation to speak out in the face of tyranny and take action to help the persecuted refugees who are simply looking to live and worship in peace. When I read that, I said, yep, that's true. But, you know, as an American living here, I also am looking for simply to live and worship in peace, and I'm not being allowed to do that because of certain beliefs that I have. There is an urgency that brings us together, and there is a sense of clarity and responsibility that we all have right now to be voices for those who have no voice. Scripture tells us that we are one body, and the body of Christ is in pain when another part is suffering. That is absolutely true. Absolutely true. He said that American Christians have literally an obligation, not simply as Christians, but we have an obligation according to Scripture to speak out and do something for the freedoms of others. Well, hey, you should do something for us too here. I'll be back on the other side of the break. And on here, now I'm going to get to the meat of the show, and it has to do with a billboard that Planting Peace erected in Kim Davis's hometown of Moorhead, Kentucky, and this is what it reads. Dear Kim Davis, the fact that you can't sell your daughter for 3 goats and a cow means we've already redefined marriage. Oh, and I'm thinking about this, and I'm saying, okay, so where in the Bible does God define marriage as selling your daughter for 3 goats and a cow? Because he didn't define it that way. Maybe some cultures did, but he didn't. So right off the bat, this billboard shows the utter ignorance and misinformation and bias and stupidity of these people because they don't get it. And there, you know, this guy, Aaron Jackson, who's the president of Planting Peace, was so excited because people are showing up taking selfies in support of this. Well, those people taking selfies are just as ignorant and misinformed as he himself. Okay, and so the only reason why I bring this up is because there's a lot of misinformation as to what, why our Christians are so adamant about, you know, our beliefs. Why are we so non-militarily militant? Why are we so stubborn? Why are we so resolved in this? What does that have to do, because I sent on an e-blast that said, what does Rosh Hashanah and Kim Davis have to do with each other? Well, I'll tell you what. We celebrated Rosh Hashanah yesterday. That's the Feast of Trumpets. And I said, oh, my gosh, everybody's going to just totally disown me now because my husband and I and two other families got together to celebrate and honor the Feast of Trumpets. Well, let me tell you, all right, that the last three feasts are shadows of things to come, and they have not been fulfilled yet, but they are very important because if you look at what that feast means, I will tell you the connection with Kim Davis. But I'm going to do a little bit of a sidetrack here because last week I spoke about Romans 13. And I spoke about this, the fact that that verse says every soul should subject itself to the higher power. Everybody. When I asked that question yesterday, on Saturday. When did I ask that? On Saturday. And I asked everybody that was, you know, at our meeting, who is everybody? Oh, well, it's all the Christians. Really? Any other takers? Who wants to say, who's everybody? They couldn't give me any answer other than the Christians. And I said, everybody, every soul means every soul, everybody. That includes government in there. So, I'm going to digress a little bit. Why was Esther queen? What was her purpose? Why did she have to be queen and to save the children of Israel from total annihilation? Because of one solitary act. Because her dear uncle, good old Mordecai, thumbed his nose at Naaman. Haman. And he said, I'm not going to bow to you, dear. Oh, my gosh, but he's government. How can you not bow and obey the decree? He didn't do it. And he got the entire nation in trouble. But God had Esther in there to get them out of trouble because Mordecai realized that the only one to bow down to, even Haman had to, was the creator of the universe, and he did not do that. All right, so don't give me this thing about having to obey the higher powers when the higher powers aren't obeying themselves. They're not subjecting themselves to that. And they're not exempt. There's nowhere in there that says that they are exempt. So going back to the Feast of Trumpets. That Feast of Trumpets, you know what the main gist of this thing is? Is the honoring of kingship. And it goes back to the time when God appeared to the people at Mount Sinai. And they said, as one man, as in one voice, yes, we will obey your law. That thing, that event happened, as far as recorded on the scriptures, one other time. That was Nehemiah 8. After they came back from captivity, and there's Nehemiah up on a platform with a pulpit and reading the law of God, and they just started to cry. Because they knew that they went as captives to Babylon because they disobeyed the law of God. And now God brought them back, and that was the first day of the seventh month, which was the Feast of Trumpets. And that's what we celebrated yesterday. So here is Kim Davis, and she's saying, I will obey the law of God. I remember the day. He says, remember the cry of the trumpet. When God's voice went out from Mount Sinai, it was like a trumpet. And then we're looking for that again. We're looking forward to that again. Where it says it in First Corinthians 15, it says this, in a moment, in a twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we will be all changed. That word trumpet, if you were to translate into Hebrew, be the shofar. At the last shofar, the longest blowing of that shofar, of that trumpet on that day. They blew it constantly, but the last one is the longest. And then 1 Thessalonians 4:16, for the Lord himself will descend from heaven. God descended on Mount Sinai with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the shofar of God. The voice of God sounded like a trumpet. It was loud. And that's what we're supposed to be looking for. Are you telling me that we're not going to hear it? Well, the last four feasts that were fulfilled in the spring were very much literal. Every single one of them was very much literal. So I'm looking for the literal fulfillment of the last three, which is the Feast of Trumpet we just had yesterday, Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement, and Tabernacles, which is all of us getting together, okay, and living with God forever. That's what I'm looking for, and that's what's going to happen. But they don't realize, they don't understand the commitment, because when you recognize somebody as king, when you recognize somebody as Lord, when you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus, you're saying, I will obey you and only you. If you ever took an oath of citizenship here that says that you have to pretty much set aside, abhor, denounce any other what? Sovereignty. Then you can be a citizen. Well, guess what? It's coming to a point where that sovereignty, okay, is being more defined, more identified. Which sovereignty are you going to subject yourself to? Which king? Because anymore, I mean, they're going to go and help the Syrian Christians to come here. But I tell you what, the Syrian Christians are going to probably be just as adamant to obey God than to obey the sovereign of this nation. Because the sovereign of this nation is not subjecting himself to the sovereignty of the higher power of God that God ordained. How did he ordain it? He said, I'm king, I give the law, you obey it. That's how he ordained it. So that's why I like celebrating the Feast of Trumpet, because it gives me a perspective of what is yet to come. It hasn't happened yet. And it's fabulous because my king is coming. I mean, I was, you know, getting ready in that song by the Gaithers. The king is coming, the king is coming. I can hear the trumpets sounding. Oh, the trumpets. And now his face I see. Yeah. The trumpet announcing the king coming. And so we got to be looking and hearing for that voice of a trumpet, the cry of the trumpet, the cry of the shofar, announcing his coming. I remember seeing old movies, you know, about the medieval ages. And whenever the king was going to come to the court, they would announce his coming, what? With a trumpet. And everybody stood up. War trumpets are also blown for battle. Oh, man, I tell you what, there's going to be a big battle happening once he comes. It's all going to hit the fan fast and furious. So that's why Kim Davis doesn't care what these people are saying that they redefine marriage, because what they put up there is so irrelevant. It's so off the wall. It's sad. I'm embarrassed for them because they're showing how ignorant they are. It is just too bad that they don't know what they're talking about. Not a clue. And this guy planting peace, he's planting peace with that billboard that 7,000 people a day look at? Are you totally kidding me? How delusional can he be? I got accused by, and I said this before, by the Southern, the League of the South, for saying, oh, we're going to unfriend you on Facebook because you're following the Talmud. And I have yet to hear how I was following the Talmud, because I don't go to the Talmud. I look to the Bible itself and see what it, the voice of God, tells me through the written word. But they were too coward to tell me where in any of my shows did I say anything about the Talmud or bowing down to it. But see, the same thing might happen with this show and the Feast of Trumpets. Well, you know what? It does not concern me. It does not matter to me, because my king speaks his voice. He blows the shofar and wants me to hear Shema Israel Adonai Eloheinu Adonai Echad. Hear, O Israel, the Lord is God, the Lord is one. Hear him, hear his voice, and obey him as king. Hope you have a great rest of the week, and I'll see you or hear you next Tuesday. Bye.